So the agenda for today, at a broad swath, we are going to go over some history, how OpenSSL and FIPS have been working together, then go into the design of OpenSSL 3.0, so that's the larger OpenSSL module. Then we dive into the FIPS module that's a companion to OpenSSL 3.0, and then we close out with current status and next steps. So we'll be talking about where the project is at, what's going to happen over the next few months and couple of quarters. And then we'll be taking questions at the end. We hope to keep time for questions. We'll also be available after the talk outside if there are additional questions or something that you need to talk one-on-one with us. So history of OpenSSL. So the OpenSSL FIPS object module, not to be confused with the larger OpenSSL. So Matt will get into details of what the architecture of the FIPS object module looks like as it stands right now. But the OpenSSL FIPS object module 101112 has gone through multiple certifications with project work starting in 2002. And that version has been compliant with OpenSSL 097. Which was last updated in early 2007. This validation is on the historical list now. So if you're familiar with how FIPS certificates work, they have an expiry. So FIPS certificates expire at the 5-year mark. And if you have not made any updates, then at the 5 years, it moves to the historical list. What that means is anything that is deployed based can continue operating. However, nothing new can claim FIPS compliance to a certificate that is on the historical list. The current FIPS object module is 2.0, which is compliant with OpenSSL 102. The project work started in 2009 and went through 2012 and slightly beyond that, but the last meaningful update happened in 2012. The sunset date for that, so when it moves to historical list after timing out, is 2022. But later on, we'll get into a scenario where it could potentially move into the historical list as early as later this year. Anything to add to that?
Just the other point to mention on that slide is the 102 end of life date has actually already passed. So that was 31st.
For the larger OpenSSL.
Yeah, so we'll talk a bit more about that.
Yep.
On the next slide, in fact, I think. So there we go. So OpenSSL has gone through a number of iterations over the years. Quite a lot of deployments out there still using 0.98, even though that went end of life back in 2015. So if you are using that, please don't move to something
it's
more
OK
recent.
To upgrade.
We went through a number of iterations, 100, 101, 102. All of those are now end of life. Current version is 111, which is our long-term support version. So that's going to be supported in through till September 23. And 3.0 is the current release in development at the moment. So just to talk a little bit more about 102. So that was our previous long-term support release, and that's still very widely deployed. Even though it is out of support. There is an extended support option, but you do have to pay for that. So for most people, you should be looking to move to 111. Now that is a problem because 102 is the only version that works with the FIPS object module. So if you need the FIPS object module, and that's a bit of a
I suppose
issue.
That's one of the reasons why it is so widely deployed. A lot of companies have to deal with commercial customers, but also regulated customers that require FIPS. And you have to make a choice, and that's why I believe you see such a vast deployed base of 102.
Exactly, yeah. Well, one of the reasons, absolutely.
What does extended support cover?
Extended support, so that covers security fixes and so on. So if there's a security fix applied to 111, then we will backport it for those extended support people.
But it does not cover any updates to the FIPS module.
The FIPS object module is no longer being maintained.
Yep. So history of OpenSSL and FIPS. If you're familiar with it, special within quotes is not an exaggeration. if you look at the what has been FIPS validated, OpenSSL is libSSL, libcrypto, but it's not only libcrypto that has been FIPS validated. It's a subset of libcrypto, which is the core cryptographic algorithms that have been FIPS validated. Even more than that, traditionally, FIPS validations for crypto libraries had been, prior to OpenSSL coming along, had been basically shared objects, dynamic libraries. The FIPS object module, it's an object module that is statically linked in. Also, there was a lot of work that was done in revalidation and porting. 46 validation updates from 2012, that's quite a bit, and 209 platforms. From what I can tell, by far the most number of platforms that has been that have been validated for a specific crypto module. And that has created churn and issues. Also, that's just OpenSSL FIPS object model purely. There are 250 other modules that leverage OpenSSL's FIPS validation. So it's wide and very diverse set of platforms. So the FIPS validations to date, I believe there have been 9 validations out of which, 8 validations out of which 5 have on the historical list, 3 that move in 22. However, there's an upcoming transition. So the FIPS validated OpenSSL object module supports RSA key generation that is compliant with FIPS 186-2. That transitions out where later this year, any validated crypto module that has FIPS 186-2 as the RSA key generation will get moved to the historical list even prior to their actual historical date coming up, so the 5-year mark coming up. There are a couple of remediations that are possible. One is updating the crypto module to use FIPS 186-4 and going through a revalidation process, a recertification process. The other option would be to change such that RSA key generation is a non-approved algorithm. So FIPS 186-2 RSA key generation would have to be moved to the non-approved list, and then it can continue existing on the list. Has OMC made a decision of what's going to happen?
No, they've been talking about it. At the moment, they've decided to defer the decision. So we certainly won't be upgrading to 186-4. So it would only be to either just allow it to go to the historical list or move it to a non-approved.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so the module, the 2.0 module is constructed with a what we call the FIPS canister. So all of the low-level crypto algorithms which are FIPS validated are pulled together into a single module, the FIPS canister. And in order to create that, the way we did it at the time was we took a fork of OpenSSL and separately maintained the code for that for the 2.0 module. And then we statically linked in that module into libcrypto. So so here's a very simple diagram of what that looks like. So you've got your end user application at the top. This is this diagram shows it where we have the end user application statically linked against libcrypto, which is this big sort of green box here. And then the box with the red dot on it, that's the FIPS canister. So that's where the FIPS validated code sits. So the important concept to get here is it's not some separate thing somewhere. It's actually within the libcrypto itself. We have the object module and the module boundary. This is the same diagram when we're using dynamic linking, and effectively it's the same thing. We've got the user application at the top, and then we're dynamically linked against libcrypto, but yet still we have the FIPS canister, the FIPS module buried within libcrypto.
which is statically in.
Statically linked in. So this architecture and way of doing things has thrown up all sorts of problems for us over the years. The biggest issue really is that because the code was forked, it's become orphaned from the main code base. There was only ever a very small number of people that worked on that that separate code, most of whom have now left the project and aren't active anymore. We had a vast number of platforms that we had to maintain, and just not enough people involved in doing it. So the outcome of that is it's no longer maintainable, and we no longer touch that code. That wasn't the plan when it was started, but that's where we are now.
And the platforms are very diverse, right? You have traditional operating systems to embedded to real time.
Exactly.
Everything in between.
The full range, which just adds extra complexity that is just not manageable at the moment.
I see a lot of if devs.
So, moving forward to 3.0. So the first thing to say about 3.0 is it's obviously based on the previous version, 1.1.1. So we immediately gain all the benefits that we have in 1.1.1 that 1.0.2 doesn't have. I'm not going to go through this whole list. You can read that yourself, I guess. But there's a few sort of interesting items on there. So we've got, obviously, TLS 1.3. So OpenSSL 3.0 will have TLS 1.3 support. Other interesting things, we've got new algorithms in there. So we've got X25519 and CharChar and Poly and all those things. We've got asynchronous support for if you want to do, I don't know, RSA or something asynchronously and get on with something else. We've got all of that support that's in there.
Move on. Sure. One thing to point out is more documentation. As a consumer of OpenSSL, it has been always a challenge to find good documentation. So more documentation is very helpful.
Yeah,
thank you for that.
Something we've been really focusing on over the last few years is improving the documentation, and everything, if it goes in these days, has to be accompanied with documentation.
Yep.
So we had a few sort of false starts of trying to get going with 3.0, but eventually we kicked off the project in earnest in August 2018. So this is a picture of the design team. We met up in Brisbane. So that's myself on the right-hand side there, and Ashit as well. So the design team consisted of lots of people getting together. So there was the core OpenSSL developers were there. We have the lab. And then we have various diverse sponsors who have been very active in making this happen. We've assembled a group of five, I think, sponsors to bring this together.
And they've been helping with engineering resources as well.
Absolutely, yeah. So it's not just money; it's
time and resources.
Time and engineering effort involved in doing that.
Yep.
Okay, so we've said this 3.0 is the next version. It's a major rework. We're basically ripping apart OpenSSL and putting it back together again. To try and sort of solve the problems of the past. This is a sort of overview diagram of what the new architecture looks like. The biggest difference is we've introduced this concept called providers. So whereas before all the algorithms just kind of sat within libcrypto, we've now pulled them out. We have, you can see on the bottom there, so we have this box here. This is the default provider. So all the standard algorithms just sit there. And then we're also introducing the FIPS provider. So this is all the FIPS validated algorithms. We have other providers as well. So we have one for like legacy as well. So legacy algorithms will sit in there. This is quite an important design choice. So the FIPS boundary, the module boundary, will be the FIPS provider itself. It gives us this new approach, it gives us so much more flexibility and enables us to plug in new algorithms and
gives the crypto agility.
It gives us the crypto agility. So we should be able to plug in new algorithms in the future relatively easily.
How does provider differentiate from the legacy engine that you had?
Right. It's a good question. So historically, we used to have this concept of engines, which did kind of provide this capability. The problem with the engine interface was it was a very low level one. It hooked in a very low level within the within lib crypto. It made it very difficult to work with, very difficult to introduce new features. It was possible to implement your own implementations of existing algorithms. You could write an engine to implement new algorithms which weren't in lib crypto, but that was really hard to do and hardly anyone did it. With the providers, we hook in at a much higher level interface. This is what we call the EVP interface. And it's designed from the ground up to enable us to plug in new algorithms, giving us that agility that we're looking for.
A couple of important things to point out. The third-party providers, so this allows you for writing your own crypto provider, validating it if you so please, and plugging it into the OpenSSL architecture. So you can still use the API calls, EVP calls, and just have a configuration set so that instead of going to either the default provider or FIPS provider, it can go to your third party provider that has been FIPS validated. So adds a lot of flexibility without having to do a major upheaval of code.
Okay, so this is just the same picture, just showing it from a packaging perspective. So you'll still get the same things that you're used to if you're using OpenSSL at the moment. You know that you have libSSL and you've got libcrypto. The default provider will actually be built into libcrypto, but then we will have separate loadable objects. So we have the FIPS module as a separate shared object, which is very different from the previous architecture. So if you're using the FIPS object module 2, the FIPS canister concept, all of that goes away. It is now a separate shared object, and that becomes the module boundary.
So it's the more traditional FIPS validation of a crypto module, crypto library. It will be a shared object dynamically linked. Matt, how does one select the FIPS provider over the other providers?
Right. So you can do that in a number of ways. So you could do it programmatically. So from a program, you can say, right, I want, an implementation of RSA, and I would like it to come from the FIPS provider, or I would like it to come from the default provider, or whichever provider you like. Or you can do it in configuration. So you can put into the OpenSSL config file, okay, I only want to use the FIPS provider, and I want to make sure all algorithms come from that provider. So as long as your application is only using validated algorithms, it will always get them from the right provider, and instantly you have a validated crypto, which we think is a powerful idea. It also enables you, which you couldn't really do in the old model. Some applications may need to use validated crypto in some situations, but in other situations it's okay to use non-validated crypto, and that enables us to do that.
So this will be an important design choice as you integrate OpenSSL 3.0 into your larger product. What's your use case? If you have a commercial version that goes into commercial space as well as regulated space that cares for FIPS, you might want to do the configuration at the global level where if a FIPS mode is set, then the configuration set to the FIPS provider and your crypto calls for FIPS approved algorithms go to the FIPS provider. This will make a very clean way to demonstrate that you're using FIPS validated crypto module. Now, if you go by the route that Matt originally mentioned, which was, you decide per algorithm which provider to use, then you have to be careful that you are using the correct provider in the right context. So this will be an important design choice to make as you figure out how you're going to integrate 3.0 into your larger product.
So yeah, the development process is ongoing at the moment. It's all public. Anyone can get involved, and I'd encourage people to do that if you're interested in this. It's all run on GitHub, so you can go on today, you can have a look at what issues we're working on at the moment, what all the pull requests are, and yeah, please get involved. Comments are welcome.
I think so they would love for more people to contribute code. So if there's one thing you take away from this talk, go contribute code.
One of the design choices we made was we're seeking to reduce any impact on existing applications. So the objective really is that 98% of applications will just work. If it works on 1.1.1 now, chances are it should work on 3.0. You will need to recompile, but it should be API compatible. It's not ABI compatible, but API compatible. We are also looking to deprecate quite a large number of the low-level APIs. So in 1.1.1 and below, you really had two choices of ways that you could do your crypto. You can either use what we call the EVP APIs, which are high-level, which might say, OK, I want to do a signature. And then within that, you can specify what kind of algorithm you'd like to use. Or you could use the low-level APIs, and you can say, OK, I want to do RSA, and then you'd have to use the RSA API, or DSA, I want to do the DSA API. All of those low-level APIs are going away. They are being deprecated. They will remain, but eventually will be removed in some later version. So we strongly encourage people to move to the higher-level APIs. And obviously, we've talked about the packaging changes that are coming up with all of the providers and so on.
So folks who are upgrading from 1.0.2 straight to 3.0, right. It makes sense that they stick to the APIs that have not been marked for deprecation.
Yes, and actually, so although the target is to make it as easy as possible to move from 1.1.1 to 3.0, if you're on an older version, that is harder. So the leap from 1.0.2 to 1.1.1 is much more difficult leap than going from 1.1.1 to 3.0 will be. So if you are on 1.0.2 or earlier today, I'd recommend that you start looking at moving to 1.1.1 as a useful stepping stone.
At least figure out what's the dev effort that is going to be required at your end so that you can plan for it. You may not be able to immediately upgrade to 1.1.1 because it does not have a FIPS claim on it, but at least you'll know what dev effort is in front of you. So we have been talking about the FIPS model design. We've covered a bunch of stuff. This is where we deep dive into the design. So these, as you see, these are the certificates that have been issued so far. None of this, as Matt mentioned, work with OpenSSL 1.1 or 3.0. So hence, if you upgrade to 1.1, you do not have a OpenSSL module that you can use with 1.1.
So the new module, I think we've sort of said quite a bit of this. So, yeah, it's had a bit of a checkered history. We actually started first looking at this back in 2012. And then we did some initial work in 2015, but it wasn't really until 2018 that we really got going in earnest. There's a few URLs there which you can go and have a look at. The one at the bottom is particularly interesting. So back in 2018, we showed you the picture of us in Brisbane. One of the outputs of that was a design document which explains exactly, in a lot of detail, exactly how we're going to re-architect OpenSSL. So if you're interested in that, go and have a little read of that design document.
And that goes back to how documentation has increased so much. That is a really good design document. It not only goes into the packaging view, all of that, what we've discussed, but it also goes into how API calls work and how they are plumbed down from the higher level down to the different providers and what kind of jumps they have to do and any hits that are taken because of that. So it's, I would strongly recommend going and looking at that. One more point, and this is on a personal level that I need to make, is when this project started, I thought, oh, you know, so many people use OpenSSL, so many care about FIPS, sponsors will be knocking at the door to contribute. I believe there were crickets. for a while. So it's good to see that issue got resolved. And
so yeah, we do have a set of sponsors, so Akamai, BlueCEDA, NetApp, Oracle, and VMware. And obviously, we're also working closely with our lab, Acumen. One of the goals that we have for the new validation, we're not going to be getting into the 200 and whatever it is. 209 platforms that we currently have. That's no longer the objective for us. So we are going to be concentrating on a much smaller set to be tested with a core set of algorithms, with the idea that other parties who may need a different platform will be able to do their own validations based on the what OpenSSL provides.
Would OMC be handling that?
No, it won't be handled by the project. We will be providing the base product, which can be used as a stepping stone for your own validation.
So if someone wants to add their own platforms, they cannot come to the OMC and say, I want to add these platforms, but they can rebrand it. So FIPS, for those who are not aware, FIPS allows a way to rebrand an existing certification, and that has been done extensively for the current OpenSSL and other similar modules. So you can rebrand, and then you own a certificate in your name, and you can do whatever you want with it, add platforms, etc.
Exactly. Okay, so we talked about the concept of providers. The really key bullet on here is the fact that this is integrated into mainline OpenSSL. So I talked earlier about the fact that with the 2.0, that the design approach was fork the code base, hack it around in order to produce the FIPS canister. And it became this sort of orphaned piece of code that no one really was very interested in. The new module is integrated fully into mainline OpenSSL. All of the code for the algorithms is shared between the default provider and the FIPS provider. So if there's a bug fix in one, both providers benefit. So I think this is a really positive thing for the future, that there's a real intention to maintain this module moving forward.
So it's no longer orphaned.
Exactly. So just putting that into a diagrammatic form of how this will work. So if you remember earlier when I showed these diagrams, the module boundary was sort of buried inside libcrypto. This is now an entirely separate shared object, which is loaded dynamically at runtime. So it's much more a traditional approach to
crypto validation, FIPS
exactly.
Validation. So as Matt mentioned, a limited set of platforms, so a total of 12 platforms have been identified. It's a mixture of Linux distributions, Windows, FreeBSD, Solaris, and then the mobile platforms, iOS and Android. So a total of 12 platforms will be tested for this initial round of FIPS validation. Typical set of crypto algorithms, couple that jump out. So AES key wrap is being moved into the crypto module. SHA-3, HMAC SHA-3 is there as well. 800-56A is important because there's a transition coming up that will have to be tested. And this time it will be in the crypto module. And perhaps the most important one is the TLS PRFs, both 1.2 and 1.3 PRFs, which in the current FIPS object module sit outside of the FIPS object module. So if you are using TLS, the ciphers that you use, you might be using the FIPS object module, but the pseudo-random function is outside the FIPS canister. So this gets moved into the FIPS object module. I keep saying FIPS object module, but it's no longer an object module, into the FIPS provider. We have also been able to significantly increase the efficiency of the self-test. So self-tests are these bar-on tests that are mandated by the FIPS requirements. It's almost like a health check. And when the original FIPS module was created, there was no way to not do certain tests. You had to run tests for all the algorithms. Given the number of algorithms that were supported, that could mean that it could be a noticeable amount of time, computing time that is required to run when the FIPS object module loads and is being used. Since then, there's been pragmatic guidance coming out of the CMVP, which is the authority, government authority that manages the FIPS program, which allows reduction in self-tests. So for example, HMAC, you do not need to run all the HMAC variations. You run just one test and that is enough. So we have used the guidance, IG stand for implementation guidance. We have used those guidance to really cut down on and make these self-tests as efficient. So we have optimized it a lot. There's also a new, more recent new guidance that came out where for software FIPS modules, you could bypass running self-tests at every load time. So you're allowed to run self-test at the time of installation, and then not run the self-test at every load time except for the integrity test. So this significantly improves performance, where you take the largest hit when you initially install a application or a suite with the FIPS provider. At that time, all self-test would be run, but that at subsequent loads, you just have to run only the integrity test would be run. So that will be a good time savings, especially on platforms with limited computing power. Also, the integrity check. So if you are familiar with the current FIPS object module, the integrity check is in memory. So when the FIPS object module is loaded into memory, there are limiters, start and end, which determine where the object module has been loaded, and an integrity check is done on what is loaded into memory. With a shared library, we can do a more traditional integrity check, which is on disk. So current status, Matt.
Right. So we recently announced the roadmap for the next few months. At the moment, we're fully focused on hitting our Alpha 1 date. So the first sort of pre-release is due on 31st of March of this year. We have a number of alphas scheduled. We're targeting the first beta release in June of this year. So at that point, we hope to see the core code complete, the API stable, and we'll have feature freeze at that point. We expect there to be a series of beta releases, not to be determined, following on from there, and we're targeting the final release in Q4 of this year. So this is just a nice pretty graph showing us tracking things, which is pretty much on the target that we hope for. So we're still that set of dates that we announced is still on schedule.
So it's pretty interesting. So we have weekly calls every Monday evening, US Eastern time, where we go over status, what's going on, what is on the plate, any questions that might come up. That's the other unique part, that as a lab, we have been able to get involved at design stage and continue being involved. So we are not, it's not that all the work will be done, then we as a lab would get involved, and then only then we would start looking at FIPS compliance. This is an ongoing process that's being built into the development. And it's interesting to see how much rigor is going into project planning and making sure that we are tracking our progress. Pretty cool.
So if you're interested, you can go and have a look on GitHub. So if you go to that URL, this shows you a sort of summary view of all the pull requests that are going on at the moment. And they're sort of classified into ones which have just been opened or issues that are we haven't yet implemented. Stuff that's under review at the moment, stuff which is finished review but not yet merged, and then also all the list of everything that's gone before. So you can get a really good overview of what's going on. I mean, these stats were done as of the time that these slides were written, and I can guarantee that they look completely different now. So,
And I'm sure once we are done with this talk, everyone will go and put in pull requests, and that to-do will increase.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So these numbers are changing every day. So you know, if you're interested, go and have a look, and you can get a real snapshot of what's going on at the moment. If you go and as I say, it's all on GitHub, so you can download the code now. You don't have to wait for the alpha releases and the beta releases if you're interested. You can go on, you can go and build it. The default, the legacy, and the FIPS providers exist. They're not finished, but they exist. So if you compile it up, you can see it, and you can play around and try things out and see what happens. So yeah, if you're interested, I'd encourage you to go and do that.
So from a FIPS validation perspective, as I mentioned, we are already heavily engaged with the OMC and the devs. We, as Acumen, so unlike the previous FIPS validation where the OMC created the algorithm test tool and the operational test tool, this time we as a lab are creating the test tool. Development has already begun both for the operational test tool as well as the algorithm test tool. That's the ACVP tool. So for those who have been familiar with the FIPS algorithm testing, it traditionally used to be CAVS testing, which is this, you know, you get these bunch of vectors in flat text files, you run it through your implementation, you get responses, which are again in flat text files, and it gets verified, and then you get an algorithm certificate. With ACVP, which stands for Automated Cryptographic Validation Program, quite a mouthful, the basic concept still remains the same. There are vectors that are provided, you run through your implementation, you get responses, and then you verify them, but it is brought into modern era. So instead of flat text files, you have JSON files, so a lot easier to parse and interpret. I tell you, I mean, most of the errors that I've seen in algorithm testing has because of parsing errors more than anything else. So this makes life easier, plus it's automated. So instead of a human having to click a whole bunch of boxes, generate vectors, package them up and send, you can directly talk to the algorithm server that is hosted by NIST and send in a query, get vectors, send responses back. The goal is to have these tools ready when code is complete. So that way we are not, we are being as efficient as possible in terms of between the time GA hits, end of Q4 2020, and we can submit to the government, to the CMVP. Right now we are planning for 4 to 6 weeks after GA. However, that can change. We are trying to see if we can make it more efficient, where we can get a bunch of testing done, reports written, everything done, so that as soon as we hit GA, we can do regression testing and go ahead and submit. When the certificate is received is a question. NIST queue times, the review times at CMVP, unfortunately, have been going up. Lately, we have been seeing and taking as long as 8 to 12 months after report submission before certificate is issued. That's unfortunately not in our hands. The good thing is we have been also engaged with the CMVP. CMVP is aware of the updates that are being done, what the plans are, and we're hoping that given the importance of this validation to the larger industry, we can fast track it. Remains to be seen. So, as I mentioned, Matt, OMC is not going to be in the business of adding platforms or rebranding, etc. But that does not stop anyone from doing it. This is open source. Anyone can rebrand. Once the FIPS validation for OpenSSL 3.0 is received, anyone can rebrand it and add their platforms to it. That's quite common even in the current FIPS object module, and it's a good way to proceed. We can work with us, you can work with the lab of your choice, it's completely up to you. The main thing is that the OpenSSL 3.0 FIPS certificate would need to be received before you can go ahead and rebrand it. other thing Matt mentioned is that this is not a point-in-time certification. The plan is to maintain the certification. So it's not, you know, validation was done in, say, 2021, and then nothing happens for the next 7 years. Logically, it's not even possible because the FIPS code is integrated into the main line. So any changes that will happen, let's say, you know, AES algorithm had to be updated, it will reflect in the FIPS provider. There are multiple paths to recertification. Again, if you're familiar with FIPS, you can do what these quick, easy updates called one subs. You know, it's in the order of a few weeks. But the requirement is that those changes cannot be FIPS relevant. If the changes are FIPS relevant, which we hope are not as often, then we can do recertifications in the form of revalidation three subs that take longer. But the important takeaway point from here is to ensure that there is commitment and every intention to maintain the FIPS certification. Also, let's say, you know, one sub or three sub takes a while, you can still continue using the older provider has been validated, right?
Yeah, so part of the design that we've come up with is this separation between libcrypto and the providers, that interface is stable. So you should be able to use, say, an older provider with a newer libcrypto. So if you want to update to the latest version of libcrypto, but you want to keep back your provider because of validation reasons, then that will be possible.
So here are some links that you can that would be useful. Perhaps I find the blog and the GitHub the most useful. And then the takeaway slide is required by RSA, and I think it is helpful. Next week, go to the OpenSSL blog for latest developments. Go to Git, contribute code. Prepare for the final release, as we've talked. It's important, especially if you're on 1.0.2. You need to figure out what your dev effort is going to be to get to 1.1 or 3.0. Identify what additional operating system, environments, platforms, and processors and operating systems are required. What the business case is for them. Whether you want to do rebrand. What your plan is going to be, and then execute on those plans. Anything to add to that?
No, I don't think so. I think that about covers it. So I think we've got some time for some questions.
Just like we have about 5 minutes.
Just a quick question. Is there any plan then to get FIPS certification on 1.1.1?
No.
So for everybody who needs FIPS certification, it's stick on 1.0.2 and then move to 3.0 when that's ready.
That's probably the best plan, yes.
Okay, thanks.
Are you guys going through FIPS 140-2 or 140-3?
140-2 right now.
Okay. Are there plans to, is the work that's being done, will that also be compatible with what's necessary for the testing purposes for 140-3, which I think starts later this year?
So, yes. Yeah, so, 140-3, it will be possible to do FIPS certification against 140-3 starting September of this year. That's the plan as of now, with a one-year transition where starting September 2021, 140-3 will be mandatory for certification. The 140-3 as a standard is still being worked upon, so the core standard is ready, but all the supporting documents in terms of how to test, how to report, all of that is being worked upon actively. There's an industry working group where vendors, labs, NIST, CCC as the Canadian side, all are involved in creating these documents. For OpenSSL, I believe most of the, there should not be any requirements that would impact compliance with 140-3. So if someone wanted to take OpenSSL through OpenSSL FIPS provider through 140-3, I believe it should be possible, but devil is in the details. So if you look at the current FIPS standard, the FIPS standard itself is 40 pages, but then there is derived test requirements and implementation guidance that runs into hundreds of pages. So it remains to be seen when the supporting documents for 140-3 come out, whether that creates any gaps in compliance. But another thing to note is that, once you have the FIPS validation, that is still valid. But just because 140-3 came out does not mean all products have to move to 140-3. It's just that products that are being newly validated have to go against 140-3.
And then the other question I had was, if I'm using one of the reference OEs, is it possible to, like, for the 2.0 provider to have a set of instructions to go from source to a validated implementation? In the same way that, like, the source, like, you know, compile it this exact way, and then you have a validated implementation. Is that how it will work for this module?
I can give my perspective, yeah, and Matt, you can. So it's even easier this time because we are not doing an object module validation. So you just run the make or compile file, and it should build you the FIPS provider. You do not have to do special magic, so to speak, this time around. So for example, in the FIPS object module, the magic has been, we have to ensure that all the compiled code is in the same, is in contiguous memory blocks. There's a start and an end, and then you have to stand on one foot and jiggle this button there and jiggle that button there. That will not be there.
Yeah, correct. I mean, we'll provide the documentation that you need in order to make sure you build it in a validated way, but it should be significantly easier than it ever used to be before.
Thank you.
Welcome. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.